The morning of our last day on Ireland started around sunrise, as we grabbed some caffeine and waited for our Game of Thrones tour bus to arrive. The first stop on the fan tour was a small port town called Carnlough. Even though it was a cold and wet morning, we were determined to make the best of it as we explored the town, and then stopped at the first Game of Thrones related point of interest. A small set of stairs down to the water, which doubled as the Braavos Canal, where Arya crawls out of after being wounded and barely swimming away with her life. It wasn't much of a sight in person, but unlike some of the sights we were shown, this one was really easy to picture, and Brooke even recreated the scene herself.
And cut.
After we left Carnlough, we headed to the second location, called Cushendon, which was home to a really cool series of caves that we actually got to go down into and see the exact spot where Melisandre gave birth to a scary shadow demon early in the show's run. Because that's a thing that happened.
HBO turned up here. They wanted to fill them up in this area because of the lightning. They approached the monastery and asked if they could keep the caves and pillars away. They were told by all means to do so, but you have to leave them back exactly as they are. They couldn't guarantee this. So simple enough, they moved from that location right on the edges here.
The next stop was a bit further away, but we were riding in luxury, so we didn't mind. We were headed to a long, iconic rope bridge, but since it was a windy day and they were apparently doing some maintenance work on the bridge, we had to go to the lookout point instead of actually getting to cross it ourselves, which was kind of a bummer. Supposedly, this location doubled as the Iron Islands for a small but key scene in an episode, but it wasn't mentioned in the tour and my research into it wasn't totally consistent. Regardless, it made for an amazing photo opportunity, so we still made the most of it. After the bridge, we made a brief pit stop at a themed pub and restaurant nearby, complete with its own iron throne, which naturally Brooke had to sit in, and I don't know about you, but I'd take her over Cersei any day. Next up was the beautiful port town of Ballantoy, which doubled as various sections of the Iron Islands, as well as the island of Pike.
We are in Pike!
Is that what that place is called?
Yeah, it's called Pike. It's the seat of House Greyjoy, and it's beautiful here. The sun is shining, and there's like no people here, so we can have it all to ourselves, which is fantastic.
Yeah, it makes feeling super sick better.
Right. Exactly. But
well, look at that. I don't know if this can get it, but it's super cool looking. It's like a painting.
It had some of the coolest show comparisons to make, even if we were too distracted by how pretty it all was to get better shots to compare. We spent as long as we were allowed here, because it was just so peaceful, and everywhere we looked was a new, amazing view. Once we were finally forced to move on, we headed to a nice festive lunch at a resort by the Giant's Causeway, which was our next stop. And it was another sight to behold that we never wanted to leave.
They stole in my rivers and hills. They built a great wall through my valleys and fished all the fish from my rills. In storing holes they burn their great fires. In storing holes they forge their sharp spears. Must I walk alone in the mountains with no true companion but he?
Eventually, it got too cold and wet to stay by the water, so we headed back up to the resort and explored the old-timey charm of the area while we waited for the bus to come back and take us to our final Game of Thrones point of interest. On the way, we stopped briefly to see an ancient castle that some people apparently still explore, even though the ceilings have been known to collapse. After that brief pit stop, we got to the last, but certainly not least, point on the tour, the Dark Hedges, which doubled as the King's Road in the show. A very iconic location for a lot of viewers, I'm sure, and it looked surprisingly similar in person. Just a cool line of trees that have naturally grown in, gnarled and ominous looking. They also challenged us to fit in a tree. I could not. On the way back to the bus, Brooke found a cat and had to take a picture of it, because of course she did. Are you even surprised? I once again fell asleep on the bus as we headed back to Belfast, but I woke up when the tour guide took some extra time to explain the history and conflict of the area, which was interesting. Once we got back from the tour, we stepped into a little pizza place with a nice atmosphere for a cheap final meal and a goodbye Guinness, and then wandered the quaint downtown area a bit more, where we discovered they were setting up for a holiday market set to open the day after we left. Figures. We also saw fantastic advertising for a local Mexican place. No one can get away from the Donald, apparently. On the way back to the hotel, we made one more quick trip to Tesco for breakfast food and another random taste test of foreign liquor we'd never heard of, and then went to sleep. The next morning, we were up before the sun to get to the bus station for a 2-hour ride back to Dublin, where we had a 7-hour flight to Washington, D.C., and then another 3-hour flight to Missouri, and a 2-hour drive home. It was an exhausting day of travel, but gave us plenty of time to reflect on the trip and the incredible amount of things we managed to see and do in just under a week's time.
Do you feel the same when I'm away from you? Do you know the line that I'd walk for you? We could turn around and we could give it up. But we'll take what comes, oh, the storm is raging against us now. If you're afraid of falling, then don't look down. But we took the step, but we took the leap. And we'll take what comes, feel the wind in your hair. else, I'll stay the course. I promise you from up above that we'll take what comes, take what comes. Love, we're walking the wire.
After literally traveling the day away, we got back home around 10 p.m. and couldn't wait to see our cats again, even if they seemed a little confused about what had happened.
Krakens! Krakens! Hey, buddy. No? Measley, why are you hiding?
Why? Did you get
me out? Nope. Yeah, he's upset. Alright. Welcome home.